You know, if Biden would just get on the news and say, don't believe the rumors. Taking large doses of cyanide will not cure COVID. He would solve a lot of problems.
Here. The loudspeaker spoke up and said, Christianity is stupid.
Greetings, fellow worker slaves, podcasting at 128 kilobits from the Fortress of Squalitude, located not far from the redneck Mecca. This is the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. I'm your host, Tucker. Professor Fuzznuts is wandering around the house, and I'm sure he'll be sneaking up on me any minute now. Buddha and Lord Squeakington are in my room. Yes, it's a podcast hosted by a guy and his cats. Get over it. And this is more of the Hex and Hammer, because I just cannot say Malefic MacMoo. And we're still in the intro. But you're going to love this. You really are. It's got some good stuff. Give everybody a brief update. And yes, I want to thank everybody who chipped in to help me get the electric bill. Still don't have my unemployment. Work says, well, you got to call the state. That's their end of the problem. Okay? In order for me to call the state, I'd have to take a day off of work and start calling at 7 o'clock in the morning. And if I was lucky, I would get through and talk to somebody before the close of the business day. So I just can't afford to do that. And rumor had it we were going to be off next week. And now they're saying, no, we're just going to miss a couple of days. I don't know what's going to happen. Obviously, if we're going to be off the whole week, then I'm going to take my remaining vacation time to cover that. If we're not going to be off the whole week, I don't know what I'm going to do. Because it depends on how many days off I'm going to be. It's going to be really hard to bite the bullet. Let's see here. Other fun stuff before we get to Hertzie and I. And Fuzznuts has decided to join us, hasn't you? Yes, he's all upset. He's not gotten any attention. Sunday was a fun day for me. It was supposed to be the day that Tasha got her second shot. But for some reason, they canceled that. No, don't get up there. Just stay right where you are. You're in my lap, and you're getting lurids. But of course, we didn't know that until we got there. I went with her. Partly to ensure that she actually got the shot. And also partly because they have one of those Coinstar machines there. You know, you feed your money in and it, you know, coins in and you get cash back. And since things are a little tight, I wanted to gather up all my change and cash that in so I have some money for this week. Until I get paid on Thursday. Well, get all the way to Kroger's where she was supposed to get her shot. And for some reason, they had canceled her shot. I don't know why. And their Coinstar machine was broken. Now, it's roughly a mile and a half walk there to Kroger's. And then, it's like, well, the next place, closest place to have it, to have one of the machines, is Wally World, which is half a mile from Kroger's. So, Tasha wanted to go see if she could get a job there at Walmart, so her and I walked to Walmart. Fortunately, their machine was working, and I got $16. That was all the change I had. That was better than nothing. And then we walked home, and that whole trip, whole process, she put in an application. She didn't talk to anybody about a job. That whole trip took a total of 3 fucking hours, roughly, because we left here sometime afternoon, and we got back around 3 o'clock. We didn't really spend a lot of time in either Walmart or Kroger's. So, you know. And of course, if I had a car, the day it would not have been that bad of a big of a deal, because we wouldn't have been, for one thing, we wouldn't have been walking in the 90 degree sun. And I, since many of you will not be hearing this until the first of the month, I want to go ahead and thank all the Patreon supporters for their help. I want to thank everybody who's donated to my Get a Car Fund. They still haven't started releasing the funds to me. And no explanations as to why they haven't done that, which is kind of frustrating. I mean, because even though I haven't reached the goal, they usually cut the money loose on a daily or weekly basis or whatever, but they haven't done anything and haven't said any reason why they aren't going to be doing it. And I could use some of that money to help get me closer to a car, even if it's not the full amount. Got to get insurance. I got to pay for shit to get my license restored. That's about what the first $1,000 I raise is going to go for, is just insurance and things like that. Because since it's been so long, I have to get what they call severe risk insurance, which is a higher premium. And I don't know what it'll be, but it might be close to $800 for the year. So, and it'd be nice to pay it all in one whack right off the bat. That way I wouldn't have to worry about it. And then, hopefully next year, just my income would be enough that I could pay it all in one whack. Or I could, switch to making monthly payments. I don't, but until I can get some money to work with, I can't do much of anything on that front. And like I said, I've requested and heard nothing back from GoFundMe as to why they haven't, released the funds. It's not a rush, but the sooner I get the process started, the sooner I can get on the road. And, here's another little fun thing that happened at work. This is just fucking wonderful. So, I think it was Friday. Yeah, it was Friday. Go in to my department. And this is near the end, later in my shift. And it's when the second shift lead is there and he's technically in charge. He's not, but he just does it because he can. So they're doing what's called plug and trim, which is the simplest way to explain it is they trim fat off of brisket for one of our customers. They serve a low fat brisket type thing, and you have to use knives and you have to wear special protective clothing so you don't get cut. And the second shift lead watches me put on all that clothing that I need to do that job, and then tells me, oh, I need you to go over here and do this other thing. So I have to take all that shit off. And then I get everything set up to do the other job. And he yells at me, I haven't got all day. The rumor at this point was that we were going to be working 12 hours. And I just looked at him and said, well, I think we're going to, last I heard, we're going to be working 12 hours. So I think you do have all day. That pissed him off. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then he just yelled and screamed. And of course, we did put in 12 hours. Oh, but I guess I need to tell you the fun part. Okay, so the fun part is we had to work Saturday. And they had this... Management came up to our lead and said, okay, at the beginning of the shift, here's what you guys need to do, and here's when it needs to be done. Now, the reason this is funny, what part of the reason this is funny is that supervisor who told our lead what needed to be done and when did it because he doesn't think that me and the other guy on days are capable of hitting those numbers. We are. And if dude paid attention to what was going on in the department, he would know that we could do it. But he doesn't. And so he's just trying to pull a little gotcha. Because things are falling apart, basically. And rather than management admit that they fucked up and need to redo things, they're taking it out on all of us. Hostile work environment, you say? I'm thinking so. Anyways, so they have a setup. I guess I should explain. In my department, we have what's known as the raw area, and that's, well, it was before they started doing the construction. It was four rooms that are just basically giant refrigerators, and that's where we would do either, we would either store the meat or we would rack the meat before we loaded the racks on the ovens. Well, yeah, we pressed for space because all those rooms were full, either with racks filled with meat or with meat in containers waiting to be racked. So they got this brilliant idea that they would use the pit room. The pit room is where the ovens are. The pit room is somewhere around the average outside temperature. There's no air conditioning in that room because there's no point. You got five giant gas-fired ovens in that room. Even though they've got doors and insulation on there, it's going to be hotter than hell, especially when you open the doors. Even if the ovens are off, they're still releasing heat. So it's not air conditioned, and they don't heat it because, you know, in the wintertime, you got the ovens going usually, so that keeps it warm. Well, since we were all crammed up in the areas where either we rack the refrigerated areas where we normally rack or we store the meat, they set us up in that pit room to rack. Now, USDA regulations allow them to do that provided the meat is only out there for a specified period of time and it doesn't rise above a certain temperature. So that's where they set us up. And then, wonder of wonders, when they realized that, oh my gosh, these guys are actually doing the, you know, getting the number of racks we told them to get by the time they're supposed to have it, they suddenly stop us and have us do this piddly bullshit for a while. Then we go to lunch, and when we come back, the USDA inspector is there, and he kind of gives some side eye to where we were racking the meat. And so he grabs a digital thermometer and starts checking the racks. And, oh, wouldn't you know it, some of them are a little too warm because they've been sitting out there long. So he flags them and that you guys can still cook them, but we got to have samples and we got to run some tests. And if they pass the tests, then you can ship them to customers. But if they don't pass the tests, you can't do it. Oh, that happened. And I don't know how the tests came out. I know they cooked them, but I don't know how the tests came out. I know that the acting plant manager has pissed off the USDA guy. So that's kind of funny. But really, if we had racking the stuff in the pit room would be fine if they could set it up, which they really can't, so that as soon as the rack was finished, it was pulled out of there and put in one of the refrigerated areas. But it's not, they didn't set it up that way at that time, and it's not really practical to set it up that way in general, just because of the size and shape of the room. We'll see what happens in the future. All right, it's tired. I'm late. It's tired. So I will talk to you soon. Mm-hmm. All right. These persecutions are very significant, and I have insisted upon them in some detail, as I wish to emphasize that stern and constant official opposition to witchcraft, and the prohibition under severest penalties, the sentence of death itself, of any practice or pursuit of these dangerous and irreligious arts, was demonstrably not a product of Christianity, but had long and necessarily been employed in the heathen world, and among pagan peoples, and among polytheistic societies. Moreover, there are even yet savage communities who visit witchcraft with death. Sure.
Yeah. Accordingly, we cite the Vincentian canon, quod semper, quod ubique, quod ab omnibus, we might surely say that from the earliest dawn of civilization, witchcraft has been prohibited, hated, and feared. Are you taking the long one?
Yeah, I am. I was just looking up the definition of that Latin phrase. What is always, what is everywhere, what is by everybody believed.
Is it by everyone believed, though?
Yeah. At the time of the triumph of Christianity, a decadent empire in the last throes of paganism was corroded by every kind of superstition and occult art, from the use of petty and harmless sympathetic charms of healing to the darkest crimes of geoetic ceremonials, spells, scrying, conjurations, evokings of the dead, were never more fashionable and never more keenly explored by every class and every order, from the divine Caesar in his palace to the local peasant in his humble shed. If the disease is universal, the medicine must be sharp. It was very difficult, when the infection of crime was so general, to discriminate and draw the line, to take into consideration relative differences and nice gradations. So much that was heathen, so much that was bad, was mixed up with what might seem to be simple credulity and the harmless folk customs of some grandam tradition and immemorial usage, a song or a country dance mayhap, innocent enough on the surface and even pleasing, so often were but the cloak and the mask for something devilish and obscene. That the church deemed it necessary to forbid and proscribe the whole superstition, even when it manifested itself in modest fashion, and seems guileless, innoxious, and of no account. Thus, for example, to make a wind blow or to drop in a worldwide fantasy, which appears harmless enough.
the Estonians when they wish to raise a wind, strike a knife into a house beam in the direction from which they desire the wind to blow. I'm going to have to try that. While at the same time, they croon an old-time kazunet. The underlying idea is that the gentle wind will not let any innocent thing, not even a beam, suffer without coming swiftly and breathing softly thereon to assuage the pain. But at Constantinople.
Istanbul was Constantinople, now it's Istanbul, now Constantinople, been a long time gone. Constantinople, now it's Turkish delight on a moonlit night.
In the reign of Constantine, a warlock named Sopater was put to death on a charge of binding the winds by magic, which he had, at any rate, essayed to do so. Whether or no, the fact that the corn ships of Egypt and Syria were detained on their voyage by calms and headwinds was actually due to his interference. Spoiler alert, they weren't. The city was nearly starved, and the Byzantine mob, clamoring for bread, was ready to break out into the wildest excesses. In Scotland, witches used to raise the wind by dipping the corner of a plaid in water, beating it thrice upon a stone, crooning the following words.
I knock this rage upon this stain, to raise the wind in the giver's name. It shall not lie till I please again.
So does that mean until she gets her free con, there ain't going to be no more, the wind's going to keep blowing?
Yeah, I'm good for keeping going. Oh, I'm sorry, was that something else?
Well, I was just saying, you know, it shall not lie till I please again. I'm not sure what they're talking about when they're talking about pleasing.
I'm just going to keep silent on that one and just let those chips fall.
Well, let you have the next paragraph. That sounded painful.
No, it's just it's like a hiccup. It will readily be remembered that one of the chief changes brought against the coven of the North Berwick witches during the famous trial of 1590 was that they performed incantations to raise a tempest which might wreck the fleet that was escorting James VI when he was brought his queen, Anne of Denmark, from her native country to Scotland. So we see that a superstition which in a little fishing village, when some mother was calling a fair wind for her son, or some lass whistled for a gentle breeze to fill the sails of her sweetheart's trawler, was simple and kindly enough, might yet become dangerous and deadly, at least in intent, when launched by malevolent witches, who had the will, if not the power, to destroy, and who, if this means failed, would hasten to employ other methods that should prove far more resourceful in their means and efficacious in their results.
Okay. Accordingly, during the years 319 to 21, a number of laws were passed which penalized and punished the craft of magic with the utmost severity. And I need to point out that I don't know the exact time period, but there are records of Romans saying that as soon as somebody learned a simple parlor trick, they were urged to go show it to the Christians because they were dumb and think it was a miracle and would give you lots of money.
Can't blame them for that.
So it's not like the early church was really opposed to magic. A pagan diviner, or haruspex, could only follow his vocation under very definite restrictions. Okay, what's a haruspex? And that's not an automatic death sentence if you did that thing, whatever it might be. Okay, so that's somebody who cuts open an animal and inspects their guts and makes a prophecy based on what they see. So they can ban them for all the and that'll make me happy. He was not allowed to be an intimate visitor at the house of any citizen. For friendship with men of this kind must be avoided. So in other words, you go hang out at the temple with them. They can't come to your house. Not that big of a deal. They may have been the ones pushed for that law. The haruspex who frequents the houses of others shall die at the stake. I find that hard to believe, because if you were a Roman citizen, you were supposed to be strangled or beheaded, not killed at the stake. That was your right as a Roman. Was to demand, if you were going to be killed, that was your right to be executed in what they considered the most humane fashion. And I learned about that because of the movie Gladiator, because there was a dispute about if they'd actually tried to kill Russell Crowe the way that they attempted in the beginning of the film. And it turns out that either one was acceptable. It is hardly an exaggeration to say that almost every year saw a more rigid application of the laws. Well, yeah, that's kind of how things work when you've got a theocrat in charge. Although even as today, when fortune-telling and peering into the future are forbidden by the statute book, diviners and mediums abound. So then, in spite of every prohibition, astrologers, clairvoyants, and palmists had enormous clientele of rich and poor alike. And I really don't understand why we don't apply fraud laws to more of those people today. However,
because we're entering towards a theocracy that, benefits them.
Yeah, I know. However, under Valens, owing to his discovery of the damning fact that certain prominent courtiers had endeavored by means of table rapping to ascertain who should be his successor upon the throne, in the year 367, a regular crusade, which in its details recalls the heyday of Master Matthew Hopkins, who I have no fucking clue who that is, was instituted against the whole race. Oh yeah, that's a slur. Of magicians, soothsayers, mathematici, so in other words, people who can add and subtract, great guys, and theurgists. I don't know what a theurgist is, but whatever. Which perhaps was the first general prosecution during the Christian era. Large numbers of persons, including no doubt many innocent as well as guilty, were put to death, and a veritable panic swept through the Eastern world, as opposed to the Western world. So who is... Oh, goody. Matthew Hopkins was an English witch hunter whose career flourished during the English Civil War. He claimed to hold the office of Witch Finder General, although that title was never bestowed by Parliament. His activities mainly took place in East Anglia. Hopkins' witch-finding career began in March 1644 and lasted until his retirement in 1647. So 3 years. He and his associates were responsible for more people being hanged for witchcraft than in the previous 100 years. He is believed to have been responsible for the execution of over 100 alleged witches between the years 1644 and 1646. That's not Texas governor signing off on execution numbers, but those are respectable.
Yeah. gotta love it when so many people are put to death.
Yeah, I know.
Can't need my mouse back. All right. The early legal codes of most European nations contained laws directed against witchcraft. Thus, for example, the oldest document of Frankish legislation, the Salic Law, Lex Salica, which was reduced to a written form and promulgated under Clovis, who died 27 November 511, mulcted those who practiced magic with various fines, especially when it could be proven that the accused launched a deadly curse or had tied the witch's knot. So, basically, like, a fine. At least they didn't kill them.
Yeah.
This latter charm was usually a long cord tied tightly in elaborate loops, among whose rectulations it was customary to insert the feathers of a black hen, a raven, or some other bird, which had or was presumed to have no speck of white. This is one of the oldest instruments of witchcraft and is known in all countries and among all nations. I would love to put that to test. It was put in various uses. The Wizards of Finland, where they sold wind in the three knots of rope. It was the first knot that was undone, a gentle breeze sprang up. If the second, it blew a mackerel gale. If the third, a hurricane. But the witch's ladder, as it was often known, could be used with far more baleful effects. The knots were tied with certain horrid maledictions. And then the cord was hidden away in some secret place, and until it was found, the strands released, the persons whom the curse was directed would pine and die. This charm continually occurs during the trials. Thus, in the celebrated Island McGee case, March 1711, when a coven of witches was discovered, it was remarked that an apron belonging to Mary Dunbar, a visitor of the home of the afflicted persons, had been abstracted. Miss Dunbar was suddenly seized with fits and convulsions and sickened almost to death. After a most diligent search of the missing garment, it was found carefully hidden away and covered over. And a curious string which had 9 knots in it had been tied up with the folds of the linen that was beyond anything difficult to separate them and loosen the ligatures. In 1886, the old belfry of the village church in England, there were accidentally discovered, pushed away in a dark corner, several yards of... Does that say incel?
Inkle? Yeah.
Okay, what the heck is an inkle? Well, it's definitely not the International Narcotics Control and Law Enforcement.
Love words. No, that's not it.
No. It is a variant spelling of inkle with a K. A colored linen tape or braid woven on a very narrow loom used for trimming. Oh.
Serge.
Yeah, so I think this is, if I recall correctly, back in the day, women's dresses would often have a piece of fabric at the bottom, at the very, very bottom of their dresses, about, oh, we'll say ankle height, which would actually match with the spelling of ankle. And the idea is that instead of replacing an entire skirt, you would just replace that part. Because that part would probably get muddy and ruin and therefore was unusable.
Right, right.
So you take that part off and then... So basically they found some...
The hem.
And considering how many petticoats one would wear during some of these times, several yards is not surprising.
Right, right. And I know that at certain times, women at the, you know, in the hems of their dresses, would have them weighted down. You know, so their skirt wouldn't blow up and tempt men.
Or heck, just blow up. I mean, I've worn long skirts. It's a pain in the ass when it decides to go up and you're just like, where the heck did this come from?
There's some, years ago when tech TV was a thing, they had a show called The Screensavers. And two of the hosts came out in kilts. And one guy routinely wore kilts. The other guy, I guess it was like his first time wearing one. And he was like, oh, this is very liberating, and proceeded to twirl around.
Oh!
And then realized there was a problem.
So,
so he had to, you know, rather coquettishly push his kilt down.
So the inkle, or the bottom of a skirt, basically, braided with elaborate care, which makes sense, and having a number of black feathers thrust through the strands. Okay, if it was in the old belfry of a village church in England for probably a fairly long time, were they really thrust? Could it be part of a, oh, say, nest? Here's a number of ways this could have happened.
Yeah, well, even if it was there originally, that could have been the style at the time when it was created.
I don't think it... Oh, well, yeah, because this was 1711. I don't think there were that many dresses with that many feathers on them. However, it's possible. But at the very bottom, I think it would be a little awkward.
Well, yeah, but I'm no expert on fashion in any time period, let alone a couple of centuries ago. But people did all kinds of really weird things up until the early 20th century. It was a big thing for women to have taxidermied birds on their hats. I mean, they were slaughtering birds in large numbers just to put them on women's hats. And that really dates me.
Well, yeah. That was a common thing, I think, for quite a while.
Yeah.
So 1600s, late 1600s, that would be Elizabethan. So you're all about the collars.
Right.
Hold on.
Yeah, but and it, but in 1886, I guarantee you, they had no way of accurately ascertaining the date of when that thing had been sealed up in the belfry.
Well, let's see here. Oh, that's right. So it wasn't 1886. So yeah, they definitely didn't have anything for that. Well, in that case, yeah, it's 1880s. That's going into the Victorian era, specifically. Right. There definitely could have been, yeah. I mean, it could have been only a few years old.
Right, right. They would have.
So it definitely could have had feathers.
Right.
I mean, heck, depending on person, you could have an entire dress covered in feathers.
Yeah.
Sorry, I got it confused with the 1711 Coven of Witches.
Right, which, you know.
Oh, that's its own thing.
Yeah.
Having another black feathers thrust through strands, it is said that for a long while, considerable wonder had caused as to what it might be. But when it was exhibited and became known, one of the local grandmothers recognized it as a witch's ladder. And what is extremely significant, when it was engraved in the Folklore Journal, an old Italian woman who had to whom the picture was shown immediately identified it as a La Granada della Strega. Meaning what?
It's an Italian phrase.
Witches of Benvento? Basically, witch's ladder, also.
Right, right. But just because some crazy Italian woman says it's the thing doesn't mean it is the thing.
No.
I'm not even going to get into that because there's all kinds of crazy shit with Italians.
Well, I mean, you can say that about insert.
Right, right, right. I mean, and I'm saying it with affection. Okay. The laws of the Visigoths, which were to some extent founded upon the Roman law, in an abstract neo-expressionist way, punished witches who had killed any person by their spells with death. Okay, that doesn't sound like it's a hatred of witchcraft in general. It's just like, oh, you killed somebody, you need to die. Which, back then, they tended to have that same attitude if you killed someone by any means, whether it was witchcraft or not, unless it was a war. Whilst long-continued and obstinate witchcraft, and how is this defined? We don't know. If fully proven, was visited with such severe sentences as slavery for life. This raises a couple of questions. Let's look at it from the perspective of someone who actually believes that witchcraft is a thing. How do you enslave a witch? And if you believe this person has mystical powers, why wouldn't you want to enslave them so they would do your bidding? You want somebody cursed? You got a witch slave, they can make it happen.
Follow-up question.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't it be witchcraft to enslave a witch?
You just blew my mind.
Cool.
Yeah. I mean, you would think it would have to be, because if the witch had any powers, they could do something to get themselves freed.
Yeah.
It's the old spirit binding thing.
Oh, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to read more from the text, so if you've got something.
It unfortunately has already escaped my brain.
Okay. In 578, when a son of Queen Fredegonde and I have Swedish ancestry, and I'm not going to apologize for butchering that name, died. A number of witches who were accused of having contrived the destruction of the prince were executed. Okay? I can think of a whole lot of reasons why this would happen that have nothing to do with them actually attempting to casting spells or even being witches.
Yeah. Again, it's that political thing.
Right, right. And, I mean, if they're using witch as simply a term for anybody who practices magic outside of Christianity, you've got one issue. And if you're using witch to talk about women who practice magic outside of Christianity, then you got a whole lot of misogyny, which ain't really surprising. It has been said in these matters that the ecclesiastical law was tolerant, since for the most part it contented itself with a sentence of excommunication. But how Christian were these people in that period of time? You know? But those who consider this spiritual outlawry lenient certainly do not appreciate what such a doom entailed. Moreover, after a man had been condemned to death by the civil courts, it would have been somewhat superfluous to have repeated the same sentence, and beyond the exercise of his spiritual weapons, what else was there left for the church to do? Oh, a lot of things.
Not kill people?
Yeah.
I feel like that's an easy thing to do, not kill people. Yeah. I do it every day.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you want to go down this path for a second?
Sure.
Okay, so, I mean, you know, we've got some misogyny here if you're assuming that witches are only women.
And even if they aren't only women, it's fairly heavy on a woman.
Right. But the other thing I was thinking about is, since, you know, in a lot of European cultures, they would have sanitized the whole fact that, you know, Christianity was really kind of flexible when it came to a lot of things that, you know, later on they'd say, no, somebody should be killed about. You know, so they would, I mean, there's accounts of, you know, Christians having polygamous marriages and all these things that, you know, later on would be just seen as horrific and brutalized.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm wondering if, you know, because they sanitized all this stuff at some point about what Christianity tolerated, because, you know, I mean, for a long period of time, Christianity was the Catholic Church and it kept consolidating its power. You know, so anybody who disagreed with him was dead. And they would have buried any records of stuff that was not related to, you know, that didn't support their particular view. So they'd kind of hide the fact that, oh, they were still holding on to pagan rituals and things like that, even if they had pagan symbols in their churches. You know, there's...
all over the place.
Right. And I mean, forget the obvious shit of, like, Christmas trees and things like that. I mean, there are black Madonna statues all across Italy. And they're not worshiping the, you know, that they weren't made for the Virgin Mary. But you think about that, and then you think about when these people would have encountered, you know, folks in Africa or, you know, outside of the European world where they were, you know, the folks were all tended to be brown. And they would be a lot less tolerant of certain practices. You know, not, you know, this religious shit would feed into the racism. Is what I'm trying to get at.
Hmm.
You know, it was a rationalization of this racism, whereas, you know, 1,000 years ago, if they'd encountered this particular group, they would have said, oh, you're worshiping the Virgin Mary. You call her by a different name and your story about her is a little wrong. It's actually the Virgin Mary, whereas, you know, later on they're like, well, you're brown and you got some funky belief, so we're just going to kill you because you ain't human.
I think there was a climb to, like, a, not climb, but maybe like a, like, it wasn't they one. Yeah, I think there was a lot of in between.
Yeah. But I'm just saying that there's, you know, that it's like, then this guy here, he may be mistaking, you know, his view may have been shaped more by the effects of things
colonialism and white supremacy?
Right, than what actual church doctrine was at the period of time he's talking about.
Fair. I was going to say, I also know that a lot of women who were accused as witches during that time were herbalists and such.
Well, herbalists, midwives, doulas.
Yep.
Just not willing to put up with men's bullshit.
Yep. And that did not go well with the patriarchy.
Mm-mm.
Lord forbid they have information.
Oh, yeah, I know. I mean.
And then they did so great with that whole midwifery bit.
Okay, so can I talk about Ignaz Semmelweis?
It's a bit of what?
Ignaz Semmelweis.
Sure.
He was a German doctor who, in about the 1840s, figured out what the midwives were doing right.
That sounds like a long ass list.
Well, specifically, at that period of time, if you were a woman and you gave birth in a hospital, well, if you gave birth and you were attended by a doctor, you were more likely to die than if you were attended by a midwife.
Yep.
So Ignaz Semmelweis decided to figure out what the fuck was going on. And he basically figured out germ theory without ever seeing germs. And he figured out...
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
He figured out that what happened was the midwives would go, you know, they would go to a woman's house. She would deliver the child, you know, the child. The midwife would leave. And, you know, the woman and the child would be healthier than if the woman saw a doctor, the doctor took her to the hospital, and the doctor delivered the baby. Why? Because invariably, the doctor, before he went to see, you know, to perform the birth, the first thing he would do when he got to the hospital in the morning was go to the morgue and inspect the bodies of his patients who died the night before. Guess what he would not do before he went to see his patients that day?
Wash his hands.
You got it. And in fact, doctors going around wearing bloody garments was considered a badge of honor. It showed they were real doctors. Ignaz Semmelweis figured out that if you washed your hands, your patients tended to survive. All this stuff. I mean, dude extensively documented it. So, you know what the medical community did?
Well, I don't think they washed their hands for a while, because it took forever for that shit to actually take.
They declared him...
I think they ostracized him?
Oh, no, worse than that. They sent him to a mental asylum, and a week after he was admitted, he was murdered by the staff. A month later, somebody came out to a, you know, made a presentation at a medical conference and said, hey, here's germ theory. And Semmelweis was mostly forgotten for a long period of time. Yeah.
Yeah,
so, and Semmelweis was murdered on August 13th, I think, or he was born on that day. And when I can remember, I posted a meme saying, let's make this day, you know, I posted on that day, let's make this day August, or, you know, Ignaz Semmelweis Day. Since we're free to listen to him, we'd have saved millions of lives. Because of how fucked up things were in the U.S. with pornography, Germ theory didn't really take hold here until the early 1900s.
There are days I wonder if the human race is just doomed. Doomed.
I take it you haven't read the articles about the UN's climate report that came out today.
Oh, I was already just thinking about the Lambda. But sure. I had a feeling it was nothing but more doom, so honest. I mean, I get why scientists don't want to say the worst, because they're like, well, we're not sure. But in all honesty, they really should have started this thing with the worst.
Well, you know, I mean, they've all been privately saying that we're fucked.
That we're fucked?
For decades now.
Yeah, the problem is that's all privately.
Yeah, I know. But it doesn't take much prodding to get them to say... It didn't take much prodding to get them to say that.
Like, recently.
Yeah.
I mean, no, it's not their fault necessarily, but it is one of those things where it's just like, oh, we've been fucked forever. Cool.
Yeah.
So great being almost 40 in late stages of capitalism right next to the apocalypse. Just great.
Yeah, I know. Believe me, I know. I mean, I am, you know, there are, I never regret not having children.
Yeah.
I never regret that.
That's it for this episode of the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. You can subscribe to the show on iTunes. It's also on Stitcher, and most of the episodes are on YouTube. Follow the show on Twitter at TParkAtheist, and it's on Facebook at facebook.com/trailerparkatheist. You can email me at trailerparkatheist@gmail.com. Show notes can be found at tparkatheist.blogspot.com. If you happen to like the podcast, please rate it on iTunes. If you'd like to donate to support the podcast, there's a donate button on the show's notes page. You can also support the show on Patreon at patreon.com/tntucker.
With the podcast, there's a donate button on the show notes page. You can support it via Patreon at patreon.com/tntucker. Thanks for listening.
Say goodnight, Fuzznuts.
All I know is this violates every canon of respectable broadcasting.
Damned cat.